amazing. He was our ambassador to Uzbekistan, and he's also been the deputy chief of the American Embassy, deputy chief of mission at the American Embassy in Kabul. He's also served in Mazar-e-Sharif and was a senior diplomat with our U.S. Civil Affairs. He served on the National Security Council, he's a Russian and Soviet expert, and he served on the Secretary of Defense staff as well. I also want to say that he's a graduate of Johns Hopkins University and the National War College, so he has both of our sponsors and hosts covered. And with that, I'd like to introduce Ambassador Norland. Thank you.
Well, good evening, and thanks for including the National War College in this program. It's actually been fun, just a little bit of the program I've taken part in this afternoon, to see folks from Norway, where I serve. Dr. Saipov from Tashkent is here, and I've been privileged to be at the table where it's practically a family reunion of the 9/11 Commission. So there's some really impressive folks in this room. I think this is obviously a really useful conference. One point that kind of brought things home for me this afternoon was when Peter Bergen said, is Al-Qaeda still a national security threat? And I think as we look backwards and look forward, it's really important to reach some judgments about that. Obviously, as Peter said, no politician can afford to ignore a threat of the sort that Al-Qaeda might generate. I remember in Afghanistan as we had the first suicide bombing in the fall of 2005. It just sent shockwaves through the system, and of course it's been downhill ever since. I worked on the Northern Ireland peace process. We saw how, even as the peace process was moving forward, a bomb at Canary Wharf really sent shockwaves through. So you can't dismiss these threats. But it is important to look forward, and I think the conference tomorrow will be especially useful in that regard. Coming from the perspective of Central Asia, where I spent the last 3 years, well, 5 years of Afghanistan, is in Central Asia. You know, to me, it strikes me that the one thing Al-Qaeda, in a way, has done for us is remind the United States painfully that we have to pay attention to this part of the world. We have, thanks to our engagement in Afghanistan, a strategic foothold in Central Asia. And the question is how we will carry that forward, even as we draw down our military presence. As you look at the shifting center of gravity in global affairs towards the Far East, the role of China, you have to remember what happens on China's western flank is going to be as important as what happens on its eastern flank. So there are strategic realities here that are part of this equation as we look forward. And the good news is there is no better speaker you could have to set the stage for the discussion tomorrow than Mike Hurley. I had the pleasure of working with briefly at the National Security Council. I think we may have crossed paths in Afghanistan, but the thing, nothing brings home Mike Hurley as well as the fact that if you open the Washington Post about a week after bin Laden was killed, there was a very, I thought, poignant profile of Mike as one of the people who had been so deeply involved in the hunt for bin Laden. And how, you know, somebody who really that whole episode took up 10 years of his life. The fact is, this is somebody who has worked on the 9/11 Commission, was deeply involved in that process, and in this public discourse project, which is following on from the 9/11 Commission. Mike was an active duty CIA officer in Afghanistan, you know, personally engaged in the hunt, involved in Operation Anaconda, came that close, I guess, and so we're talking about somebody with on-the-ground operational experience, also worked at the NSC, so he's seen things from the White House perspective, and now is in the private sector as the president of his own company, Team 3i. Working on strategic kinds of projects for private clients. So I think we're extremely fortunate to have somebody of Mike's caliber and perspective, and it's my great honor and pleasure to introduce Mike Hurley.
Ambassador Norland, thank you so much for that very kind introduction. You did leave out one thing, and that is that, and I think it's important to know, I grew up in a family with seven brothers, so from a very early age, I got excellent training in terrorism and counterterrorism and guerrilla tactics, actually. It's a great pleasure to have a chance to talk with you all tonight, and there are so many things that I want to talk about. Some of what I'm going to say comes from a white paper released a week ago by the chair and vice chair of the 9/11 Commission. I'm going to take liberally from that, which I can do because I had a small hand in drafting it. So if I'm plagiarizing, I'm sort of just plagiarizing from myself, which, come to think of it, is a pretty good source. Winston Churchill once said that history would be good to him because he intended to write it, and he did in 6 volumes. But anyway, now on the really solemn occasion of the 10th anniversary of the attacks, it's really important, I think, to reflect and evaluate where we are in national security reform and what we have yet to achieve. How secure has the United States made itself since 2001? I really think that's one of the key questions. And how do we keep our country and allies and innocent people around the world safe? What's the story of the last 10 years? Well, we've come pretty far. The 9/11 attacks were an event of staggering importance. There was the before and the after. Step back for a moment and think about the past 10 years. Here's a fact that strikes me. We haven't suffered a major attack here, at least at the kind of scale of a 9/11 attack and what we feared in the days, weeks, and months after the 9/11 attacks. Why? There's lots of reasons for that, at least in part because there's been dramatic change in our country. We went on the offense. We took the fight to the enemy. Secretary of Defense Panetta said recently, while still director of CIA, that we are within reach of strategically defeating Al-Qaeda. The killing of Osama bin Laden helped. Bin Laden is dead, but Al-Qaeda is not. It's still adaptive and resilient. It's a network, not a hierarchy. Zawahiri is alive and has taken command of it. It's fragmented and decentralized, still lethal in places like Yemen, Somalia, Pakistan, and elsewhere. The Bin Laden success, I believe, highlights many reforms that have taken place since the 2001 attacks. The excellent cooperation between special operations forces and the CIA. I really think it was extraordinary. Really, in a way now, the combatant commander of a lot of this against violent Islamist extremists is now the director of CIA. This is a profound change. Just look at the use of the Predator, the unmanned aerial vehicle that's gotten so much use lately. In fall of 2001, before the 9/11 attacks, then CIA Director Tenet was raising at Principals Committee meetings, the highest level meetings of the United States government national security apparatus, about whether he should actually have the trigger for the Predator. I don't think he wanted it, but he definitely wanted everybody on board if they were going to give it to him, and he wanted the principals to think through, what does this mean? So think about how that's changed. So there have been dramatic changes in our government. Massive reorganization, creation of the Department of Homeland Security with its now $53 billion annual budget, a surge to more than $80 billion annually on intelligence, the creation of the Office of Director of National Intelligence, the National Counterterrorist Center, new commands in the military, Northern Command, Cyber Command, significant changes in the FBI and CIA. We'll talk a little bit about that. CIA, the Washington Post recently argued, has become central to killing the enemy. It seems to be its primary role now, another profound change. Just think about our lexicon now. Really, in the days, I was trying to think back, before 2001, we didn't really talk about homeland security, talk about national security. Use of the word homeland really kind of came up after the 9/11 attacks, I think. Obviously, the economic effect on our country and the world of the attacks and their aftermath has been huge. So we went on the offense. We clearly also hardened our defenses in many ways. So what is the threat that we face today? I think the biggest threat to our national security in many ways still comes from affiliates of core Al-Qaeda. Peter Bergen, who you know from his appearance today, in a report he co-authored a year ago for the chair and vice chair of the 9/11 Commission, highlights the threat from Al-Qaeda jihadists, calling it a strategy of diversification. Attacks mounted by a wide variety of perpetrators of different national and ethnic origins and backgrounds that cannot be easily profiled as threats. I commend to you Peter Bergen's The Longest War, his latest book. It's an insightful account of the last 10 years and of the threat and challenges that we face today. Most troubling, I think, is the pattern of recruitment of American citizens and residents, these so-called lone wolves, and people who become self-radicalized, in many cases, over the internet. In 2009, there were two actual attacks on our soil, Fort Hood shootings that claimed 13 lives, and a U.S. military recruiter was killed in Little Rock, Arkansas. Somali youth are being recruited in Minneapolis and Portland, Oregon, in some respects moving the front lines to the interior of our country. These are really, really big problems. It's really simply impossible to know the inner thinking or pathology of every person that's at risk in the country. Al-Qaeda is kind of adopting this fragment of Al-Qaeda, sort of a strategy of innovation. We saw in October 2010 the discovery of explosives packed in toner cartridges addressed to Chicago synagogues and shipped on FedEx and UPS cargo flights from Yemen. It failed, but clearly these guys are looking for new ways to inflict great harm and damage. That would have been an attack without even crossing our borders, really, the people doing it. Cyber attacks is potentially a big problem. Our leaders, our Homeland Security leaders, have been warning of cyber attacks to critical infrastructure, electrical grids, financial systems, telecommunications. That could be a nightmare scenario. That's what some are calling it. I think as the current crisis in Japan shows, the disruption of power grids and infrastructure can have devastating effects on society. It's not science fiction. It's possible to take down cyber systems and trigger cascading disruptions and damage across a large area. I read with great alarm, this is now a couple of years ago, what seemed to be an offhand or nonchalant remark by a Chinese general interviewed by some obscure economic journal. And he was sort of asked, well, do you fear, does China fear war with the United States? And it was the nonchalance of his reply that sort of said, no, you know, we don't really fear it, because in the first few minutes we're going to throw a switch and knock out all the United States' telecommunications coming from satellites. And then we're going to throw a second switch and disrupt their financial communities. I don't know if they're capable of doing that. I don't know if it's possible, but people are sure thinking about these different possibilities. So that's the threat. And so what has the country done? Well, there's been substantial reform and progress. I'm not going to go into all these details, but just consider, for example, the creation of the National Counterterrorist Center. I think most people regard that organization as a pretty good success. It's made mistakes, that's for sure, but it's a pretty good success. I mean, let's compare it. Lee Hamilton, who was the vice chairman of the 9/11 Commission and my boss, said that the commission said it's always hard for politicians to set priorities. Sometimes it's hard for the intelligence community to set priorities as well. Anybody here remember the Terrorist Threat Integration Center, TTIC? That was the precursor of the NCTC. They produced, and this is in the months after, and years after, the immediate years after the 9/11 attacks, something called the Threat Matrix. Anybody remember that? The Threat Matrix sort of collected every day all the threats that were kind of coming in to our vast system, whether through diplomatic channels, intelligence, military, whatever it happened to be. Local law enforcement. Basically, the threat matrix was put together and kind of dumped on the president's desk. Here's 115 or 150 threats. I'm not really sure what good that does, because unless you tell the president how to sort of prioritize decisions, it's not really solving much of a problem. We're a lot better at that now, I think, than we were in those initial days. So big change at the Central Intelligence Agency as well, too, I think, in terms of the sharpening of intelligence and analysis. The FBI. A lot of people think that the 9/11 Commission went easy on the FBI, that it should have been reformed more than it was. But it has changed in substantial ways. It has taken its focus, in large part, still doing law enforcement, but it's deeply involved in counterterrorism and intelligence work with respect to terrorists. It wasn't really all that solid on that before the 9/11 attacks. Creation of all these joint terrorism task force across the country. I think there's 105 of them now. And there's something like 72 fusion centers. It gets to the whole question of information sharing, which we were sort of poor on in many ways before the 9/11 attacks. I think we're better now at that, and I'll talk a little bit more about it, but it's not perfect. I'd like to reserve kind of discussion of the Director of National Intelligence and how that's working or not working as you see it, for questions and answers a little bit later. So I think we're safer today because of all of this. But we're not ultimately safe, we never will be, because there are lots of things that have been left undone. I think there's some unfinished business that the government has to deal with. The 9/11 Commission recommended that it was really important to have a unity of command and effort, something that's very natural to our military, but to have this sort of implemented across the country for responding to either man-made disasters or natural disasters. Now, we made some progress in that, and I think if, depending on who you talk to from the Department of Homeland Security, they'll sort of say, well, we've got this covered. You go around in municipalities around the country, and you talk to the police chiefs and fire chiefs, you get somewhat of a different story. It's not always altogether clear. If we go back to Hurricane Katrina, if we go back to the oil spill, a Gulf oil spill a bit more than a year ago, there were some glitches in that whole effort. The centralized, sort of system was set up so that there was one person in charge, an admiral, but states were still kind of going in their own direction at times, and that can be a bit of a problem. One problem that we haven't solved that I think is really appalling is we still don't have complete interoperability of radios to be used in emergency response. That's really appalling, because all you have to look at is what happened in New York City on the day of the attacks. We lost hundreds of firemen and policemen because of the inability to be able to communicate on incompatible radio systems. We do not have the bandwidth reserved for specialized use in emergency situations that the country needs. It's a big political problem and a big political fight, but the fact that it hasn't been done in 10 years is really an appalling problem. I think another thing that hasn't been done, and this was a key recommendation of the 9/11 Commission, was the creation of a Privacy and Civil Liberties Board. We've had so many changes in our country, so many laws and regulations and different procedures all over the place, that we really do need sort of a board that analyzes and evaluates the trade-off and the balance between security, which is very important, but also maintaining privacy and civil liberties and striking that right balance. The 9/11 Commission recommended the creation of a panel to do this. The Bush administration created it and staffed it out, selected a few of the panel members for it, but it never really did very much of anything. The Obama administration, surprisingly to me, has named two people for it, but they've never met, there hasn't been a quorum, and it hasn't done anything. And I think, but more importantly, the chair and vice chair of the 9/11 Commission believe that this is an appalling failure. That even just the notion of being able to explain to the American public why certain steps are necessary, to say that we've looked at this and evaluated the impact on privacy and civil liberties, and this makes sense in the broader scheme of things, is really important, and we're lacking that now. Now, Congress was very quick to insist that other agencies in the national security community make significant changes and reform, but the 9/11 Commission also recommended important changes that Congress reform itself in terms of oversight of intelligence and homeland security. It really hasn't done that. So quick to sort of criticize others and insist that others make changes, but congressional leadership has not stepped up to the plate to reform Congress. And it's not just a question of reform for reform's sake. If you're in the Department of Homeland Security and you're getting oversight by a total of 88 committees and subcommittees, you're not really getting coherent advice or instruction. And Congress's role really should be to help these important agencies in the national security with those kinds of responsibilities do good work. That's what they should be doing, working hand in hand. And it's hard to do that when you have fragmented oversight, and Congress has been unwilling to change. And I'll tell you that the chair and vice chair of the 9/11 Commission hit Congress hard about that recommendation. It's one that really should be fulfilled, and we need to focus on it. Again, I want to kind of reserve discussion about DNI, which is really important maybe for questions and answers. On transportation security, we need to really improve the ability of screening checkpoints to detect explosives on passengers. You know, people kind of going through these machines and so on. You know, it's possible to still get through. The technology is still wanting, and it's probably going to be a problem in the future. The commission recommended that we also have biometric exit screening. We kind of know when people are coming into the country now. We don't know when they're leaving. We don't know if they overstayed their visas. That was a problem before 9/11, because a number of the 9/11 hijackers had overstayed their visas, and that's pretty important. What about standardizing secure identifications? The commission recommended sort of standards in birth certificates and issuance of driver's licenses, and states were supposed to get on board. I think about a third of the states have complied, but it means two-thirds haven't. And their deadlines have been extended by the Department of Homeland Security until 2014, I think. It's really pretty unacceptable. We have to know who people are when they're getting on planes, you know, when they're going into places where they can cause problems and so on. So getting that straightened out, I think, is hugely important. You know, another thing is the whole question of developing coalition standards for terrorist detention. I don't want to get too much into that issue, but this has been a problem that has vexed two presidents. It's very, very difficult to resolve this. How are we going to treat these prisoners? And I think this is a Congress problem. This is a problem for congressional legislation, because they have to pass legislation and spell out, these are the procedures, and this is how this should be handled. And that hasn't been done. I mean, the government, the president needs help on this. And the fact that two presidents with, I think, all goodwill and good intention to resolve this really tough, thorny issue have been unable to really make substantial progress is indicative of that. I think the Obama administration did something pretty important at the beginning of the administration, which was to review all the cases of the folks, people held in Guantanamo, and to sort of start sifting through that. I think that's a good first step. But Congress needs to get involved. We have to determine, as a country, what the procedures are for handling these people. We have to codify them into law. I think that's really, really important. And let me talk a moment about counter-radicalization. That's really important that, you know, our friends in Europe have dealt with for a long time. I don't think we fully focused on this in the United States. You know, counter-radicalization, how do you keep people from becoming radicalized? It's not just a question of law enforcement and law enforcement going into the communities that might be at risk. It's already too late if you're at that point. You have to be on top of this. Basically, I think what we need to do is inoculate these communities and inoculate particularly the young people and the young men who are at risk from the virus of Islamist extremism. We have to approach this also in a coherent way. I think if you ask most people, it would be very difficult, even experts on counterterrorism, for them to identify just what department or what individual in the United States government is in charge of our counter-radicalization policy. It's very hard to place. You know, I recommend a recent report on this that the chair and vice chair of the 9/11 Commission put out, kind of pointing out, I think, in a very constructive way, what the difficulties are in terms of our overall counter-radicalization policy and what needs to be done. So the threat is still evolving, I think, from Al-Qaeda in some ways. You know, I go back to right after 9/11, and I think about, you know, this great fear that we had, that people in the intelligence community, in the military, those that have been reading intelligence that were involved in what Al-Qaeda was up to, had about the fear of a nuclear weapon or nuclear materials getting into the hands of Al-Qaeda. This is recounted, I think, pretty well in the memoirs of George Tenet, who was director of CIA at the time. But in fall of 2001, soon after the attacks, there was deep, deep concern across the Washington community that A.Q. Khan, the sort of rogue, you know, father of the Pakistani nuclear program, had sort of, you know, proliferated weapons potentially to Al-Qaeda. Nobody knew, but there was at least some evidence and some intelligence about this. Tenet recounts this in his book, and it's very interesting to read this. But this really, I mean, this is one of the things, besides the anthrax scare and all the stuff that was going on after the 9/11 attacks, as we were sort of, you know, figuring out what had happened and what we needed to do about it, this was what was keeping people really in the know up in those first couple of months to try to figure out, had that exchange taken place? Did Al-Qaeda have some very, very dangerous weapon? Could something be in the United States? And the big concern was, what if we don't find this? What if something like that has happened, but we miss it? That's really what was on people's minds. I'll tell you an anecdote from my work on the 9/11 Commission. I had on my team, I headed the counterterrorism policy investigation, had a very, very bright young historian from Columbia University with a PhD in history. He's a brilliant guy. And both he and I were kind of doing the investigation of National Security Council decision-making with respect to Al-Qaeda. And one day, as part of the many interviews we conducted of people that had been staff jobs at the NSC staff, we went and we interviewed a very, very bright woman who was had a responsibility in the counter sort of terrorism directorate there to sort of track nuclear weapons and, you know, the possibility of terrorists, you know, having them. And I remember being in this interview with her. So this would have been in late 2003, I think. And we were sort of asking her questions to describe what had really concerned her. And I was a little bit, you know, I wasn't jaded exactly, but I'd been reading intelligence, and I, you know, I kind of knew that there was this big threat out there. My colleague, though, was kind of new to this, and he was very, very bright, and we were asking questions, and I remember her telling us, because she was in this key office, I think, from like 1997 onward, and she told us that on many drives from her home into her office at the White House, on any particular day, she thought she might see a mushroom cloud over Washington, D.C. from a terrorist attack. And you should have seen the reaction of my colleague. I mean, he was horrified. I was horrified, but he was petrified. Why? Because the public had no inkling that these experts have those kinds of concerns about our country. And that was the first indication for him. That all led to a key 9/11 Commission recommendation. You may remember it. And the 9/11 Commission said that our number one priority needs to be keeping the most dangerous weapons in the world from falling into the hands of the most dangerous people, Al-Qaeda. The interesting thing now is this is not emphasized as much. Things have changed. It's a big change. In recent threats assessments, you don't really sort of see the emphasis on the fact that there may be a nuclear attack. I mean, I don't think it's completely ruled out, the use of a dirty bomb. But I think it's not, you know, it doesn't have the same emphasis that it did. We still need to worry about it, of course. You have to sort of weigh the likelihood or the probability of something like that occurring versus the gravity of harm, which would be obviously severe and changing of society if it actually should take place. So here are some things that I've been thinking about. You know, the awareness that we've all had since the shock of the attacks is maybe one of the most important and underrated attributes of our success, I think, in preventing attacks over the last 10 years, or major attacks. And I don't mean, by the way, to minimize the Fort Hood shootings with 13 people killed. That was severe and tragic. And a Senate review of that basically suggested that it could have been prevented. And that's what report worth reading as well, too. Because we can learn things from these kinds of reviews. You know, think of the pre-9/11 mindset. The 9/11 Commission, I think, pointed out very fairly weaknesses in CIA's portraiture of Al-Qaeda before the 9/11 attacks. Obviously, CIA, the military, everybody was very aware of the threat from Al-Qaeda, but there were still weaknesses in the portraiture. But the Commission said, and I think this is a really telling kind of conclusion or point that the Commission makes, so I want to read it to you. The Commission said that both Presidents Bill Clinton and George Bush and their top advisors told us they got the picture of the threat. They understood bin Laden was a danger. But given the character and pace of their policy efforts, we, that is the Commission, do not believe they fully understood just how many people Al-Qaeda might kill and how soon it might do it. We said at some level that is hard to define, we believe the threat had not yet become compelling. And our public, despite the attacks on our embassies in East Africa in 1998, despite the attack on the USS Cole, I think 17 sailors killed, maybe 40 or 41 grievously wounded, $500 million damage to a US warship. And going back to the East Africa bombings, I think there were 12 Americans killed. There were over 200 and some Africans, 5,000 wounded, and over 1,000 of the Africans wounded were blinded by those attacks. But despite all that, our public still didn't have a clue, I think, about the hatred these people bore us. We knew about intense anti-Americanism in some countries, but not in others. So it was kind of shocking. And I heard that from everybody, you know, people that I know, people that I went to school with, you know, people in my home community. Let's take a look at the big picture. I want to mention a colleague of mine who was a brilliant colleague from the 9/11 Commission. He was the executive director named Philip Zelikow. He has written, by the way, an afterword to the latest edition of the 9/11 Commission report that has just been issued in connection with the 10th anniversary of the attacks. If you haven't read it, I highly recommend that you read this afterward. It's always worth paying attention to what Dr. Zelikow says. And so I'm going to make a few of his points. These are his points, but I think they're really worth considering here. One of the things that he says is that one of the most common misunderstandings of the 9/11 Commission report is that the Commission blamed the attack, and I actually say here, I'd say blame the failure to prevent the attack on a lack of imagination. And the implication is that if only the government had done more out-of-the-box thinking, the attack could have been averted. But as Dr. Zelikow says, our point instead was that the imagination of large organizations must take an institutional form to be carried out effectively by ordinary people every day. That means the development of a craft or a culture of routine procedures. Part of the problem of 9/11 was that parts of the government had actually already mastered the craft of analyzing surprise attack dangers, but had not systematically applied its proven techniques to the enemy that in 2001 was most likely to attack the United States. So we had these procedures. We didn't really use them, though. And the procedures themselves, the warning, knowing when warning was important, and being able to warn of a potential attack, obviously developed during the Cold War, really had their basis, and it was borrowed from engineering. Engineers consider the most credible, likely dangerous pathways that will lead to a catastrophic failure. And then they look for telltale indicators, and they collect intelligence on those indicators. It seemed like there was an element of randomness to our collection of intelligence on Al-Qaeda, and it wasn't really sort of knitted together. I think it's interesting to think about. So I've talked about the threat. And here is, again, I'm going to direct you to what my colleague from the 9/11 Commission, Philip Zelikow, how he sees it. Because, again, I emphasize, he's always worth listening to. And he kind of summarizes it this way, and you'll see this if you read his afterword. He says, by 2004, Al-Qaeda was seriously weakened. And I think that's true. It regained strength in Pakistan and Afghanistan in some respects in 2006. Ambassador Norlin's well aware of that from his position there. And we saw the plot to blow up several commercial airliners over the Atlantic. In summer of 2006, I think, that was averted. But it would have been a complex plot. In 2008, the United States government stepped up its tempo of missile attacks into the Pakistan sanctuary because of all these things that were going on. President Obama, as you know, has accelerated the tempo of that. I think it's true that, and as Zelikow says, that the organizational capability of Al-Qaeda today now seems to be back at the level it had in the mid-1990s. Its scattered fanatical adherents, though, have crystallized in some places. The most deadly recent attack on U.S. soil was carried out by a solo fanatic, the army psychologist inspired by Islamist propaganda to murder 13 people at Fort Hood. I think the danger of global Islamist terrorism is now fairly significantly reduced from what it was on 9/11. In Pakistan, it's probably true that the core, I emphasize the core Al-Qaeda, is down to a few hundred reliable operatives. That's Dr. Zelikow's position as well. From Richard Reed to Christmas, to the Christmas 2009 underwear bomber on the Northwest Plain, the risk of catastrophic terrorist attack is significantly lower than on 9/11. But the risk is not zero. It's far from zero. And it's true, I think, that an attack could happen at any time. What shape will it take? We don't really know. Would it be a swarming Mumbai-style attack? You know, would it be an Oklahoma City sort of attack? Would it be something different, a Fort Hood kind of shooting? I don't know. We saw that attempt in Times Square, you know, a year and a half ago or so. Those things we have to consider. So an attack really could happen at any time. Politically, as Zelikow says, we can't downplay the danger or right-size the enemy to a more normal proportion. It's really difficult to do that politically. He calls that the paradox of adjustment. The efforts to right-size or to normalize a reduced risk seem, in Dr. Zelikow's words, too risky. The most serious threats are posed by a relatively tiny number of people, few in number and not well organized. But they can be bands of zealots. To some extent, I think we succeeded at denial of sanctuary, but with very important qualifications, like parts of Yemen and other parts of the world. We've also succeeded, you know, in interdicting travel in many instances and disrupting terrorist financing. I think that's a pretty good success. A 9/11 Commissioner, Richard Benveniste, though, says that we might best combat terrorists by taking away the terror. And I think that's an interesting insight that he has. As Dr. Zelikow says, contemporary societies will remain vulnerable to the abilities of even a few people to do terribly disruptive things. How we deal with failure, because there will be some, we need honest self-examination and thoughtful accountability. We need to go on the offensive against the most dangerous groups, rely on local allies, where they're reliable, I'd add, and regional strategies, develop those to shape conditions on the ground and contain dangers. So what's Dr. Zelikow saying? That we can scale back? I don't think he's really saying that. The threat is diminished, but there's still a big problem with potential lethal attacks. And that's going to be with us for a long time. So what does it say about funding and how we should allocate our money and set our priorities? You know, for the first time, I'm noticing that Congress is really getting interested in the question of how much money are we spending on all of this. Lee Hamilton, the vice chair of the 9/11 Commission, sort of says, when he talks about it, he's asked that question, we need to rationalize spending. He sort of says that, you know, the immediate concern of Congress and our leadership after the 9/11 attacks was the security of the country, obviously, and of our people. Our leadership didn't really care about what it cost. Can't really do that now anymore. And these tough decisions have to be made. And like I said, for the first time, I mean, you're sort of seeing questions, you're seeing senators and representatives sort of raising these issues. And I think it's important that we do that. You have to figure out what's working and what isn't. Is it just a calculation, though? I remember the old deterrence strategies that the United States government had, and many of you here do as well. They worked in the era of two superpowers. Speaking of that, by the way, I always thought the Soviets would blow us up, and just before we were smoked, we'd blow them up. And look what's happened instead. Our own bankers have blown us up. But in those days, it was nukes versus nukes, equations versus equations. The deterrence was really kind of mechanistic in a way. I mean, go back and look at the classic films, Failsafe and Dr. Strangelove, and you get a sense of that. Sort of like once the doomsday machines were set in motion, the opera was ending because the fat lady was singing, and she was singing Goodnight Irene. But it's humans versus humans now. That's what I think we really have going here. That's what we confront. What the New York Times' Tom Friedman calls people of mass destruction, people that strap explosives on themselves, you know, to blow up a base, a CIA base in eastern Afghanistan. So how do we deter them? I know there are theorists, I've read about these, who say that we can do that and that these committed zealots can be deterred. I'm really not so sure how, and I haven't been persuaded by any of the arguments that I've seen. I think it's a fruitful area to investigate. And what are our positive differentiators here in our country? I think we have a lot of them. Our capabilities are enormous. Believe it or not, our big organizations can be agile and nimble when they need to be. We've already probably all seen this in our careers. You know, what can we say about ourselves that the enemy can't say that they can do because of the pressure that we keep them under? Just a very quick anecdote. I mean, years ago, I worked, when working in the intelligence for CIA, there was a kind of big bad bank in the world called BCCI, Bank of Commerce and something or other international. And it was moving a lot of drug money, you know, narco money from South America, just hundreds of millions of dollars. And what I came to understand, this was kind of a very early point in my career, is if you kind of look at CIA, the way the military works in some respects, you have this system of a chain of command, and it can get amazing things to happen very quickly all over the world, figuratively speaking, by pressing the button. But when we moved, and I don't just mean CIA, but our diplomatic friends, you know, our people in Treasury and so on, to crush that bank's transactions, it happened overnight. You know, démarches made all over the world when everybody's lit up to go at the same time. You know, and the narco traffickers, the money people in South America, didn't know what hit them. And you know, we have those rather amazing capabilities, and I think that's a big advantage to us. When the system functions well, it functions beautifully. It doesn't always function well, and we've seen that. A big, huge comparative advantage for us, I think, is information sharing. It was pretty appalling before 9/11 for all kinds of reasons. I remember a story, an interview that we did with a three-star general at the Pentagon. You know, who really had responsibilities in the area of terrorism, but for reasons that were unclear to us, was sort of kept out of some of the decision-making and some of the different things. But I know people have different jobs and need to know and so on. But this was really way too closely held before the 9/11 attacks. And I think we lost a lot of brain power. We certainly never included the 19,000 state and local law enforcement organizations that we have in this country that were clueless, basically, about the threat that we faced. And that's one hell of a lot of experience that we didn't take advantage of, and it was really a shame. Things are profoundly better now, I think, albeit imperfect, as we all know. Today, for example, we have software with amazing power that interconnects just about everything. But there's always a price. I urge you, giving you these reading assignments tonight, take a look at a new book called Triple Agent by Joby Warrick of the Washington Post that tells the story of the Jordanian doctor, Al-Balawi, who was recruited by Jordanian intelligence. You have to read this account. And this is the guy that strapped explosives to himself and blew up seven CIA officers, some other people at the CIA forward operations base in Khost, Afghanistan, a year and a half ago. That's part of the price, I think, that we pay, you know, as we aggressively try to deal with this threat. And there's always a price. We can never be afraid to ask the question, though, you know, what's really working and what needs to be done? Do measures that we've implemented, are they keeping us safe? And is it lessening the chance of terrorism? And here we get back to the price. Think about the use of the Predator. The Predator strikes have accomplished a lot, I think. They've killed enemies of the United States and enemies of the West. Killing those enemies have protected a lot of people. But the truth is they're double-edged. They are, because there's always a price. Do we know who the strikes are radicalizing? How many people they're radicalizing? It doesn't take much to radicalize people in these parts of the world, in Pakistan, in the sanctuaries, and so on. Just a big problem. Again, it's anecdotal, but there are a few hard answers in this area. So we gain some benefit, and there's a price to be paid. We have to analyze that. That's the reality. It's messy. But terrorists are not going to give up, even if the threat is diminished to some extent. We have had our successes, but we really can't let our guard down. That would be a huge mistake. We're going to see new attempts and successful attacks. We're safer than 10 years ago, and we've hit the enemy hard. But we have to regularly assess, reassess, and recalibrate. And I hope that's what's going on with you in your work. Whether you're a manager or not, you know, just taking a look at all of this, raising questions, recalibrating, anticipating what are the best ways to stay ahead of a determined enemy. One of our major deficiencies before the 9/11 attacks was the failure by national security agencies to adapt quickly to new and different kinds of enemies. We're better at adapting now, I think. But when our story is told, what will it be? Overreaction? Reason? Did we keep our heads when confronted with a new and horrific reality? I think for the most part we did, but in all honesty, we've made mistakes. Peter Bergen's The Longest War makes that clear. Again, I commend that to you. We've missed opportunities, and there really is much more to do. Overall, I have to say I agree with many commentators that the U.S. military has been the greatest source for peace in the history of the world. I remember I had some role, minor role, in the Kosovo conflict and policymaking. And I remember the leader, the president of the Czech Republic at the time, Václav Havel, speaking before the Canadian Parliament in Ottawa in spring 1999. Just as the NATO bombing of Serb forces was taking place. And he was talking about Kosovo, and he said that, you know, this very eminent leader and historian, really, he said that the U.S.-led coalition was one of the most altruistic acts in history. We didn't get anything out of what we did. You know, just very little. Take a look at that. I think that in confronting the challenges that we face with terrorism, we're going to move forward using our brains and our know-how more than our role.